We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that our unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yeah, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other, we will work side by side. We will work with each other, we will work side by side. And we'll guard each man's dignity and save each man's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yeah, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Instead, make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in the way of a brother or sister.
Pastor Dave is preaching this sermon this morning, and he asked me if I would take care of children's time. I'm like, that would be awesome. And Frank and Katie and Savannah are here, so perfect. We're going to do a quick children's time lesson on liberty and love, freedom and love, how we practice our freedoms, but also how we respect and love the people who are around us. But before we do that, I want to let you know that Alex is in the building. Sister Alex is here, and Alex did build that snowman, probably in 5 minutes, 10 maybe. Alex is so, so skilled. And then Savannah, I forgot to ask Savannah. Savannah said she would rename my saw for me. And so Savannah's come up with a name.
The Shredder.
So now we have, instead of the Frankenstein, the Shredder. So I have a Frankenstein, a Shredder, and a Wrecker. How's that for saws, eh? Isn't that exciting? All right, liberty and freedom. So one of the rules for today is that we don't stand too close. And even as we're speaking, we're trying to speak forward and not be too close. That's part of just part of dealing with the pandemic. And some of our friends are much more sensitive about that than others. And one of the things that I think we should address is, how do we practice what we feel is a liberty and also respect our neighbor? So my first question to Savannah is, what are you doing with that hockey stick anyway?
It's for social distancing.
For social distancing? How?
I think that's about 6 feet.
Oh, perfect. The Canadian social distancing tool, the hockey players' social distancing. And if you get too close, they know how to use the hockey stick. Yeah, for sure. All right, Katie has a plate of cookies. And so the question I'm going to ask Katie is, say if you have absolute freedom to eat as many cookies as you want, and you just love cookies and you love having cookies around, but you have a friend coming over who's dieting and has a weakness for cookies, what should you do with the cookies?
I think I'll put them away.
That is a loving choice, a great choice. Putting the cookies away, that's so hard sometimes, and recognize some of the things that tempt our friends. So put the cookies away. Frank, you've got hot dogs. What if you have a lot of us have some really good Jewish friends, and we know that they have a sensitivity toward hot dogs, or we have vegetarian friends who really practice vegetarian seriously, and boy, we invite them over. What should you do with the hot dogs?
I think we should put these away also.
No more hot dogs. Katie does have a suggestion though.
I have kosher dogs.
Is there really such thing as a kosher dog? Seriously? All right, we have another question. This one's for Savannah, and I love this question. So Savannah and the rest of us have a really special friend. Her name is Hannah, and she happens to have diabetes. So we have to be careful with what we have when Hannah's around. But Hannah also has low blood sugar. So Savannah, what should you do with the cookies?
Put them out.
Just for Hannah, a big plate of chocolate chip cookies. Hannah, we love you.
Hey!
Busted! Hey.
Good morning. If this is your first time joining us here at Pilgrim, I want to welcome you. And if it's not your first time, welcome back. We're glad that you're able to join us and worship with us today, whether it's in person or online. My name is Dave Martin, and I'm the associate pastor here at Pilgrim Lutheran Brethren Church. Today's sermon is entitled, Does Your Liberty Love Your Neighbor? We'll be looking at 1 Corinthians 8, 1 through 13. And we'll be addressing the question, as a Christian, how much should we let other people's views influence our actions? Before we begin, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much today for your word and for your church and for the ability to worship. Lord, we pray that you'll be with us today, that your word will fill us with wisdom that beyond understanding. In your heavenly name, amen. If you would please turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians 8, 1 through 13. If you're not familiar, 1 Corinthians is what's referred to as an epistle or a letter from the Apostle Paul, and he's writing in response to some questions that the church in Corinth had sent him. This letter was written in 52 AD. Now, only 2 years earlier, in 50 AD, the Council of Jerusalem sent Paul and Barnabas on a missionary trip to the Gentiles or the non-Jewish people. That same year, Paul established this church in Corinth. Corinth is a very large, prosperous seaport. It has inhabitants from Greek, it has retired Roman soldiers, slaves, freedmen, transient sailors from around the world, and people from many different ethnic and religious backgrounds. It's estimated that there were between 100,000 and 600,000 people living there, and immorality and idolatry were normal everyday life there. The most prominent landmark at the city's highest point was a temple to Aphrodite, the Greek goddess of love, pleasure, and fertility. So imagine Paris with a mix of Chicago and Las Vegas. Corinth had Jewish synagogues as well as many other temples to other idols and gods. And in many of these temples, animal sacrifices were offered. As part of the sacrifice, that meat would be divided, and some would be given to the idol, and some would be for the family to eat, and some would be for the priest. Many times, the meat would be available to be eaten either in the temple itself, or it would be sold on the market, and it'd be hard to tell which was which. So most of the meat that was available in Corinth was meat that had been sacrificed to idols. If you wanted a good steak, it was probably sacrificed to an idol. And if you wanted to eat with the social elites, the food was probably sacrificed to an idol. And if someone who had been converted to Christianity wanted to eat with their family, probably the food had been offered to an idol. You guessed it. Almost everything was offered to an idol there. So the question that was being asked to Paul was, is it okay for Christians to eat meat that was sacrificed to idols? Well, let's read the text. 1 Corinthians 8:1 through 13. Now, concerning food offered to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. This knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. If anyone imagines that he knows something, he does not yet know as he ought to know. But if anyone loves God, he is known by God. Therefore, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that an idol has no real existence, and that there is no God but one. For although there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as indeed there are many gods and lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom are all things and from whom we exist. And one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. However, not all possess this knowledge, but some, through former association with idols, eat food as really offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not condemn us to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat it, and no better off if we do. But take care that this right of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if anyone sees you who have knowledge eating in a temple, will he not be encouraged, if his conscience is weak, to eat food offered to idols? And so, by your knowledge, this weak person is destroyed, the brother for whom Christ died. Thus, sinning against your brothers and wounding their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food makes my brother stumble, I will never eat meat, lest I make my brother stumble. We seem to have two differences of opinions in the Corinth church. Their church is divided on the issue of eating meat offered to idols. On one side, we have those who have knowledge. They say, if there's only one true God, then isn't an idol just wood? And the meat, it's just meat. So let's enjoy our freedom and eat this meat without being bothered. But on the other side, we have those with a weak conscience. People are likely those who actually came from these religions and have been converted. But they say, if a Christian eats meat offered to an idol, isn't he or she in some way worshiping that idol? You see, really, the question isn't about whether or not they're eating meat. The question is, as a Christian, how much should I let other people's views control my actions? Should I be willing to sacrifice my liberty because of another person's views? I recently heard a sociologist say that we humans are inclined to be tribalists, that we break into groups. Our human nature gives us a tendency to be divisive and to separate into us and them. And we argue to justify our beliefs, not to understand our opponent's position. I don't know. Do you think that that's true? Let's try an experiment. Let me ask you a couple questions. Which is better, dogs or cats? Which is better? Which one's a better diet? Keto, where you only eat meat, or vegetarian, where you only eat vegetables? Which is the better football team, the Cleveland Browns or the Steelers? I got the most important question. Toilet paper, over or under? Right? Why are we even asking this? Everybody knows it's over, right? How do I know this? Well, I have proof. I found a meme on social media that shows that over is the correct answer. Now, those are all silly things that divide us. But what about more serious things? Let me ask you, is COVID-19 a serious threat or no? Do we take a vaccine or not? Do we wear masks or not? Republican or Democrat? Let me ask you this one. Which is more important, the sanctity of life or social justice? I would assume that most of us have opinions on all these topics, and we have arguments prepared to support our positions. Like the Corinthians, we are convinced that all of us possess this knowledge. We all know. Don't all the best arguments always start with, everybody knows, blah, 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 blah. Somehow we're able to convince ourselves that our position is the only acceptable position. And rather than unite us, our positions on these types of topics serve to divide us. To divide us as a people. To divide us as a nation. To divide us as the kingdom of God. But that's not what we're called to do or to be. Let me ask you another question. What is the mission of the church? What is the Great Commission? Turn to Matthew 28, 19 through 20. Jesus says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you to the end of the age." Jesus is sending us to them, to people with very different beliefs and ideas, a similar situation the folks in Corinth found themselves in. Now, there's something else I think we need to know. You see, that question, whether or not meat offered as sacrifices to idols should be eaten, the Corinthians already know that answer. When they sent Paul to establish the church in Corinth only 2 years earlier in 50 AD, the Council of Jerusalem sent with him a list of what Jewish customs Gentile converts were to be held to. The good news was they did not have to be circumcised. However, they did have to refrain from eating blood, meat containing blood, the meat of animals that were strangled, fornication, and idolatry. So these second-year students of Christianity have posed a question. They're challenging the rules. In academics, what's the name for a student in their second year? A sophomore, right? Well, did you know that the word sophomore comes from two Latin words? The first word, sophos, means wise. And the second word, maros, means foolish. That's where we get the word moron from. So sophomore actually means wise fool or wise moron. It means, yeah, you know some stuff, but just enough to be dangerous. Paul could have just put his foot down and he could have said, you know what? You already know the answer to this question. Or he could have said, why? Because I said so, that's why. But look at 1 Corinthians 8:1. Look at how Paul handles this. "Now concerning food offered to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. This knowledge puffs up, but love builds up." What knowledge? What knowledge do they believe that all of us possess? The knowledge that there's only one God, the very God that we worship. Paul says, if we aren't careful, this knowledge, it puffs us up, or it can make us prideful or arrogant. It can breed an attitude of, I'm right and all the rest of you fools, you're wrong. Instead, Paul places alongside this prideful knowledge, love, a love that builds up or edifies. Look at verse 2. If anyone imagines that he knows something, he does not yet know as he ought to know. But if anyone loves God, he is known by God. Let me ask you, what's the difference between knowledge and wisdom? Knowledge is knowing stuff, but wisdom is knowing how to appropriately use that knowledge. Look at verses 4 through 7. Therefore, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that an idol has no real existence and that there is no God but one. For although there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as indeed there are many gods or many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom are all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. However, not all possess this knowledge, but some, through former association with idols, eat food as really offered to an idol, and their conscience being weak is defiled. You see, initially Paul agrees. He says, yes, there's only one God, the Father, and there's only one Lord Jesus Christ, and yes, idols don't really exist, but that doesn't mean that everybody thinks this way. Paul describes this one group as having the weak conscience. A conscience is that inner voice, that tiny voice inside of us that helps guide us between what's right and what's wrong. Some brothers and sisters are probably still struggling with their previous life in idolatry, and every day they're being pulled back. And at the same time, these other Corinthians with the knowledge are insisting they have the liberty and the right to eat whatever they desire. Look at verse 8. Food will not commend us to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care that this right of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if anyone sees you who have knowledge eating in an idol's temple, will he not be encouraged, if his conscience is weak, to eat food offered to idols? Paul says, yeah, what we eat or don't eat, it doesn't get us any closer or any further from God. So technically, sure, you have the right to eat whatever you want. But take care or be careful that exercising your right doesn't cause a brother or sister to fall back into sin or to fall away from God. Take care because there are consequences. Look at verse 11. And so by your knowledge, this weak person is destroyed, the brother for whom Christ died. Thus, sinning against your brothers and wounding their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food makes my brother stumble, I will never eat meat, lest I make my brother stumble. Did you notice that Paul doesn't tell the Corinthians what to do? He says, yes, because of our salvation in Jesus, we have many freedoms and rights. But with great knowledge and great freedom comes great responsibility. If we don't control our knowledge and our liberty with wisdom and love, we may be wounding our brother's conscience, sinning against him and sinning against Christ. Basically, what Paul is saying in verse 13, he says, you do what you want, but for me, Paul, if food makes my brother stumble, I will never eat meat. Now, some might be saying, too bad for the weak brother, because I love bacon. Well, turn with me to Luke chapter 17, and let's look at Jesus' thoughts on causing a weaker brother to stumble. Luke 17, verses 1 through 2. And he, Jesus, said to his disciples, temptations to sin are sure to come, but woe to the one through whom they come. It would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were cast into the sea than that he should cause one of these little ones to sin, or the NIV says, stumble. Take care, because there are consequences. We need to take care that our liberty shows love for our brother, for our sister, and for our neighbor. In Matthew 22, Jesus was asked, what's the greatest commandment? And his response was, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. This is known as the law of Christ. As we determine how much we should let other people's views influence our actions, may this law of Christ be what drives our conscience. And may we take care that these rights of ours do not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word. Your word is truth, Lord. We thank you that we can come to you with our questions and our fears. And Lord, in these difficult times when we have to make many decisions, Lord, we thank you that your word speaks to us, that you can guide us in how we make decisions and how we express our liberty and our freedom. Father, we pray that you will just work in our hearts this week and these coming months. We pray all these things in your heavenly name. Amen.